Thanks so much for being a part of LifePoint Online today. Now, we recognize that some of you are a part of our Smyrna campus, our Stewart's Creek campus, or our Riverdale campus. Some of you live in Middle Tennessee or around the world, and you haven't yet come to one of our campuses. We want to welcome you to being a part of this gathering today. You know, we recognize that some of you right now, you're sitting in your dining room or your living room or your kitchen. Whatever it is, wherever you're at, we know that whether you're alone, whether you're with family or friends or with your life group right now, whether you're watching on a phone, on your computer screen, or even on your television, we ask that during this time that you would approach this moment, that you would approach it with an open Bible, that you would approach it with an eager mind, and that you would approach this time with a hungry heart. During this time, we're going to have the opportunity to pray together, to worship, to give, and we believe if we lean in, the opportunity to grow. You know, we are in a moment that is unlike anything we've ever experienced, and we hope that you will tell the story of this moment. We ask that you would post a picture or tell the story of how you and where you are gathered together today to watch this and be a part of this gathering. We also want to let you know that during this time, there are online pastors that are there ready to pray with you, to talk with you, to interact with you. Take advantage of that opportunity today. This is an unprecedented moment in our history. This is a time that will be talked about for years, for decades, maybe even centuries to come. And at LifePoint, we believe that this is not the time to just lay back and ride this thing out. No, we believe that God is leading us to lean in, because we believe in a God who is saving. We believe in the Spirit who is moving, and we believe in a Jesus who is living. If you are looking for a time and a place and a way to find life in the midst of chaos, you are in the right place. Thanks for being a part of this gathering today. Let's worship together.
Would you please stand wherever you are and sing this together? In a time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. Broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe. Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered hell. We believe in His resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe that this morning. So let our faith rise. So let our faith be more than those, greater than the songs we sing. In our weakness and temptations, we believe, we believe. We shout it out. Good morning. Let's hear from the word of the Lord. Psalm 27, verse 1 through 4 says this: "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." Would you close your eyes and pray with me as one church gathered in many different locations, but one spirit unites us right now. And that spirit gives us boldness and bravery. The third person of God is with us. We are not alone right now, church. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would meet every single one of your children today, wherever they are. That right now, wherever they're watching, your spirit would fill their hearts. I pray that your spirit would fill their mind, their whole entire body, that they would be aware that you are near, that you have not left us alone. You are with us, right beside us, before us, behind us, around us, within us. God, we know that you are here. And so I pray that you would just open our eyes, open our minds to know you are close. Lord, we are covered in your presence, made possible by the blood of Jesus Christ, shed upon the cross by his death, through his resurrection, and in his ascension. And he is waiting to come back again, as we've just sung. So, Lord, I pray that today you would embolden, by the power of your spirit, through the power of your word, embolden your body this very day. We have nothing to fear because you are with us. You are aware of our anxious thoughts, and we pray, Lord, that in the name of Jesus, that those fears, those anxious worries and thoughts, where everybody is in a different story, in a different circumstance, but you meet them in that, Lord, would you just calm them down, knowing that you are in control and that your church is on the move, because you are on the move. God, we worship you. We praise you. Would you make us fearless? Fill us with boldness and courage this very day. It is in your precious name we pray. Jesus Christ, amen. Let this be our prayer this morning. God would make us fearless.
Though you walk through the darkness, our God is Singing together. As we do, we lift up Christ. He's our steady anchor in this time. As we sing this together, let's lift our eyes to Him. Let's hold fast to Him as our anchor. Jesus, we look to You. We lift our voices to You. We give You our hearts now as we sing. Sing Christ, our sure and steady anchor.
Christ, our sure and steady anchor in the fury of the storm. When the winds of doubt blow through me and my sails have all been torn. In the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few, I will hold fast to the shall never be removed. Never be removed. Christ the sure, steady anchor, while the tempest rages. The battle, and it seems the night is won. And deeper still in goes the anchor. Though I justly stand accused, I will hold fast to the anchor. It shall never be somehow. Oh, my soul, now lift Your eyes to Calvary. And this my ballast of assurance, see His love forever proved. I will hold fast to the anchor that shall never be removed. Oh, Jesus, lift up.
thank you, Jesus. Lord, we lift your name high. You are our anchor, our steady, solid rock, our foundation in every storm. When the world around us is reeling with fear, God, we have you to trust in. And we have no reason to be afraid, because if God is for us, who can be against us? So God, we look to you for strength right now. We look to you for boldness, for fearlessness. God, we know that you have not given us a spirit of fear. Your Holy Spirit is not a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and self-control. So God, we look to you. We rest in the cross. We're covered by your blood. And we look to you, God, for our grounding in this time. We look to you for the strength of our faith in this time. God, be everything we need. We love you. We lift your name high. We give you the glory you deserve this morning. And we look to you for help. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, thank you for joining us as we worship online today. And man, our band did an incredible, incredible job. We sang Travis Ryan's greatest hits, basically. Two of those three songs, We Believe and Fearless. Man, Travis wrote those amazing songs. Obviously, Christ Our Sure and Steady Anchor. I mean, wow, how awesome is that song? I don't care if you're worshiping at church, at home, on the moon. Those songs are awesome, and I hope you were able to participate and join with us as we worshiped. And I'm gonna let the cat out of the bag here at the end of the service. We're going to sing another one of his songs that's one of my favorites, is You Hold It All, and which is very appropriate for the time in which we are in at this moment, right? And you know, I thought that this was probably the only time that I could remember in 26 years of being at LifePoint that we had canceled a Sunday morning service, or I would say suspended or changed it. But I was reminded this morning by one of our team members that a few years ago on Christmas Day, because we worshiped on Christmas Eve, we went online. We did an online thing for Christmas Day morning so that parents and families could worship together. Outside of that, this is the only time that I can ever remember in 26 years that we have ever canceled the in-person gathering. And that's how important it is to us, folks. I mean, we believe that gathering together as the body of Christ is a vital and fundamental aspect of the Christian life, okay? And so, man, that's why we do not cancel. That's our policy, is we will be here. I mean, there have been times when we've had to tell you because of snow or ice or whatever, hey, look, use your discretion, but we're here. You know, we're sort of like the mail. The old saying with the mail is like, man, we're going to deliver. Rain, snow, sleet, or hail, we're going to deliver. And so we're here. That's what made this decision so really agonizing for our team, just to be honest, okay? I mean, man, we want to be here. I miss my family when I'm not here, my church family. When I'm away, I miss you guys. I look forward to Sunday mornings. I hope you do as well. I look forward to hugging you and crying with you and laughing with you and just what families do, and I miss that, and I hope you miss that. But I want you to know this is not leaning back. This is leaning in, and that's the theme of what I want to talk to you about today. This is not a time to lean back, and I don't want to look at this as a challenge or a negative. I want to see it as an opportunity for us to advance, okay? Not retreat, but to advance. And we're going to talk about that some. And I hope that today this message helps not only give you some reassurance, but also some vision for what we're going to do. Now, folks, I mean, you know me. If you're a part of this church, I mean, this is a little awkward for me. We do have some people in the room today. We have 80 to 100 of our staff members and their families came to worship. But outside of that, there's no one else here. And so I'm having to really speak to you. And y'all know me. I like to move around and shout and dance and all that kind of stuff. And so this is a little awkward. And so I'm also going to try to speak a little slower. And the reason is because if you're a part of our church, then you know that we have a Spanish translation that takes place. And so what we've done today is on the fly is we've got people all over the community and all over the world, really, and they're translating. Some of their children are translating, standing beside the TV. And so I'm going to try to help them out as good as I can, all right? And so, man, thank you. Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for being here. And this was agonizing, okay? I mean, to make the decision to worship and our homes and online. It was really agonizing. I called as many people as I could call. We talked. We talked to healthcare professionals. We talked to scientists. We talked to infectious disease people. I called pastors. I sought as much counsel as I could about what to do today, okay? And after much prayer, many hours of meeting, and a lot of counsel, we felt the best thing for us to do to serve our community, the most responsible thing we could do to serve our community would be to suspend our in-person gatherings until further notice. Now, folks, this doesn't mean we're canceling church. Obviously, we're here, okay? Our staff is going to be here through the week. We're working. We're gonna be here to meet your needs and to counsel if you need counseling and to pray if you need prayer and all those kind of things. Our staff's working. We're not canceling church. We're not even canceling our gathering. We're just changing how we do it, all right? And so thank you for joining us. Although it's virtual, we're not forsaking the assembling together as God's people, as commanded by Hebrews chapter 10, all right? And so now I know some people would say, well, it's just, some of it's fear. We're not gathering because of fear, or we're overreacting. I understand that. I really, really do. And I understand it because that's our tendency, isn't it? I mean, we tend to respond to situations and circumstances, to be honest, like a drunk driver. We go from ditch to ditch, and, we overreact. I don't know if you know this or not. I know you do, but really, objective journalism is a thing of the past. It's no longer a thing, right? I mean, there's no such thing as let me give you the facts as I see them. It's always let me give you the facts as I color them, right? Everything now, I don't know of many news outlets or true journalism places. It's all op-eds. And it's op-eds, and their goal is to get clicks, to get headlines, and to get sound bites. And so the way things are presented a lot of times cause us to overreact. You don't believe me? Go right now to the store after the service, let's say. Go to the store and try to get some toilet paper, all right? I mean, it's almost empty. Because of people over. Matter of fact, if you own stock in Charmin, we ask that you tithe early and often to the church, okay? Because toilet paper is just, it's people stocking up on beans and rice and toilet paper and all those kind of things. And my wife was at the store this week, and she was standing in front of the rice section, I mean, like a foot from it. And just as she was standing there looking, there were two bags of rice, and a lady came up and just grabbed those bags of rice. And I'm thinking, boy, if you know my wife, she's getting ready to throw down. But thank the Lord she didn't. But, we can overreact, okay? We can overreact, and we can hoard toilet paper. We can do those things. On the other hand, let me tell you what we do is we underreact. Right? I mean, we do nothing. There are people who say, oh man, just don't worry about this stuff. Why are we letting it stop us? Don't let this disease, this virus beat us, right? I mean, let's go. Let's go. Let's trust God and have faith. And when I hear that, I laugh inside a little bit because I'm from East Tennessee, and in East Tennessee, that's sort of what they say right before they pick up the snakes, you know. It's like it's gonna get hurt. And so either way, we don't want to go in a ditch. I don't want to drive my truck in a ditch because I love my truck and I don't want to do damage to my truck. Actually, I don't want to pay for the damage, and somebody's got to always pay for the damage. Well, we don't want to drive in the ditch when it comes to the coronavirus because, man, we know it'll cause damage. And so what we want to do is we don't want to overreact. We're not going to hoard toilet paper. I hope you're not hoarding toilet paper and all that kind of stuff. And we don't want to overreact and hoard toilet paper, but we also don't want to underreact and do nothing. Here's what we want to do. We want to trust God and have faith, but love and serve our community, okay? And we just really believe that the best way to do that after a lot of counsel, a lot of prayer, is to pull back and to suspend our in-person gatherings until further notice so that we can help slow down, do our part in serving our community by slowing down the spread of this virus. Now, I want you to hear what I said right there, okay? We're not doing this because we're thinking, we'll do this and we'll eradicate this. I mean, I'm not a doctor or son of a doctor, or, I'm not a scientist or son of a scientist, so I'm not going to stand here and say, man, we're going to overcome this and it's not going to go far. It's not so that people won't necessarily get it. It's just trying to slow it down so that our hospitals are not overwhelmed all at once. Okay? Because if our hospitals are overwhelmed all at once as it's spreading in a rapid fashion and we're contributing to that, then when someone has a heart attack, goes to the hospital, and then there's no bed, there's no supplies, man, I don't want that to happen, okay? We want to do our part, and so we really feel like we're blessed in a time when we can go online. We're blessed in a time when we can give online. We can worship at this time and for a time frame. And I also want to challenge you in this time, rather than saying, man, I... It's such a negative. We're not able to worship. Let that connect you to our brothers and sisters around the world who have to worship like this regularly, or they can't meet every Sunday. Maybe they're being persecuted. They're meeting underground. So let that connect you with our brothers and sisters all over the world, and thank God for the privilege that we have of being able to do this regularly, not just in person, but even if we have to, online, okay? And so what I want to do for the next few moments is I hope to give you some words that will speak to the unrest. Our schedule was to begin a series going through the book of 1 Timothy today. I love that book. It's going to be really good for our church, and we're going to still do it. But I felt like I needed to call an audible, you know, really like yesterday. Friday night, we started thinking, man, we need to do something. And so I had that sermon all worked up. So we called an audible, and I spent yesterday thinking about what really does our church need to know right now? What does our world need to know? Because although I'm preaching to a few people in a room, The blessed thing is how God's blessed us is we're really not just preaching to a few people in the room. We're preaching to a lot of people around the world. We literally have people from all over the world watching right now, and we're glad that you are. All over the world, I don't want to even say watching, worshiping and participating. And so what would I say to you? That's what I thought yesterday. And, man, there's a lot of different things that we could talk about. And so I want to speak to give some reassurance in a time of unrest. But I also want to give a vision of how this is not a retreat. This is an opportunity to advance the gospel, okay? And so I want to do those things by giving you some do's and don'ts, all right? And the theme is that I kept as I was last night, as I'm in my chair and I'm writing this thing at home, and I keep thinking, man, we don't need to lean back. We need to lean in. We don't need to lay back. We need to lean in. Right? And so that's sort of the theme. But let me talk to you about some do's and don'ts that I really think we need to do in this time in order to not lay back but lean in. And the first thing we need to do, let me address first some unrest and some frustration and all that in people all over the world. Matter of fact, I know that even our Brussels campus had to suspend today, and some other campuses, and perhaps even our Bangkok campus. And so this is a worldwide issue, okay? And so the first thing I say we need to do is we need to don't worry, trust God. Don't worry, trust God. Now, I think that's relevant because worry is something that we know well. Matter of fact, we're on first name basis with worry a lot. I mean, and today there's so much to worry about. Let me give you some examples, okay? I mean, you got the COVID-19 coronavirus, aka coronavirus, global pandemic, okay? So that's going on. You've also got Russia and Saudi Arabia. They're sort of in a contest to see who can spew oil the farthest. I mean, they're in this oil war that's creating this stuff. You've got the threat of war in Syria, which would then create a refugee crisis that we've seen, you know, not too long ago, that was sad. And you've got kids that are home from school, and moms and dads are like, because schools are canceled, and here in our area, schools are canceled, and a lot of places around our country. So moms and dads are like, what am I going to do with my kids? I got to go to work. I don't know what to do. And so there's worry there. And, you know, to be honest with you, I'm not concerned or worried about getting the virus. I'm not in that segment of the population that is like that, you know, it's a major threat. Now, don't get me wrong, it's a threat to some segments of the population. I'm not concerned about getting the virus. You know what I'm concerned? I'm concerned that the stock market's got the virus. Some of you are there too, because you see, maybe you're close to retirement, and you're like, man, what am I going to do? There's a lot of things that cause us to worry, right? There's a lot of things that cause us to worry. And what I want to point out to you is we can not worry if we trust God. Now, gone are the days when we can simply worry about one crisis at a time. There were years gone by that we had a crisis. I remember years ago when the Gulf War happened, man, and I was like, man, that was a crisis. And there, in your time frames, you remember different crises. We would have a crisis, and then at that time, it seemed like we would get through that. This too shall pass. We would get through that. Then, you know, maybe it would be a few years, a few months at least. Then we would have another crisis that we'd have to manage. Then it got to where it was one after another. But today we live in a world where we literally have to learn how to manage multiple hysterias at one point, at the same time, okay? And so what do we do with that? How do I handle all these hysterias? Where do I go, right? And the real deal is most people go to the news or to the internet, the World Wide Web, to social media, and you know, or to Google. And you know, I Googled last night worry. I just Googled worry, how to deal with worry, and I got 518 million hits. 518 million articles or websites on how to deal with worry. Now, I didn't read them all, obviously, but some of them give some good information. Some of them are written by people who forgot to pay their brain bill, okay? You know that. And so rather than, here's what I want you to do. I think going to a lot of those social media, if you go to social media, if you live on social media, then you're probably going to be socially inept, all right? And if you listen to the op-eds that we used to call journalists, you're probably going to be like, I mean, filled with anxiety. So rather than just reading social media, I would encourage you to read God's word. Rather than listen to all the news, listen to the Holy Spirit. Okay? And so rather than turning to Google, let's turn to God. And so what does God have to say about worry? Okay? Because worry is a real issue on many levels. And so what does God have to say? Well, I want to go to what I think is one of the key passages. All of God's word is full of God's words. These words are Jesus's words when he was living on this planet. And here's what he says in Matthew chapter 6, verses 26, when he's dealing specifically with worry and anxiety, okay? Here's what Jesus says. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious. Boy, that's relevant, isn't it, to the moment, about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will not he much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Amazing words of Jesus, and as always, not just appropriate to the generation and to the culture in which he was writing them, but very appropriate to the generation and to the culture and today and what's going on. You know, he was speaking to first century Jews, and we always really want to try to put ourselves into the context of Scripture if we really want to know what it means. It's easy for us to read this and fly by it because we really don't get it. You see, when it comes to food, most people in our world here in America, most people, I would say, they don't really worry about food as far as where I'm going to get it. Our biggest worry is where we're going to go to eat, right? I mean, our staff, for instance. Some days when our staff goes out to eat, and man, our biggest concern there is not, are we going to have anything to eat for lunch? It's where are we going to go? We'll spend 10 minutes making a decision on where we're going to go to eat lunch, right? I mean, maybe you and your wife do that. That's a good day when that's our biggest problem, right? But maybe that you know this from getting in the car with your wife or your husband. You're going to eat. Where are we going? I don't know. Where you want to go? I don't know. Where you want to go? That's our biggest problem, right? Well, that wasn't a problem for the first century Jews. See, their problem wasn't where are we going to go to eat. Their problem was, is my child going to have anything to eat today, right? Their problem wasn't, you know, which shirt am I going to wear? That's what I did this morning. I went into my closet as I was getting ready. I went into my closet, man, and I got a shirt and I put it on and I went to the mirror and I said, I don't want to wear that shirt today. And I pulled it off and I put another one on and this is the one I landed with. And some of you are going like, well, you should have worn the other one probably. But my point is this. We get together, we say, man, I mean, when we're getting ready, we say, does this shirt match these pants or do these pants match these shoes? And so I need to get another pair of shoes. That wasn't the first century Jews. The first century Jews, their issue was, do I even have a pair of shoes, right? And so when Jesus is speaking this, he's speaking about not luxuries to them, not the 401k, not all that. He's speaking to necessities of life. Food and clothing are pretty important. If you don't eat, you die. And if you don't wear clothes, you go to jail, right? And so these are pretty important issues. they're necessities. And he says, listen, when it comes to not just luxuries, but necessities, don't worry. Don't worry. And we can look at it and say, oh, Jesus, that's idealistic. You know, that sounds pre-fall, pre-Genesis 3. In Genesis 1 and 2, I understand that because Adam and Eve, there was no coronavirus because there was no sickness, there was no death, there was no divorce, there was no falling stock market, there was, you know, none of these issues that cause us to worry. But sadly, Adam and Eve crashed and burned, and when they crashed and burned, what happened? They brought in all this sin. That sin brought in all of this disease and falling stock markets and all these things that cause us to worry. So how do we do it post Genesis 3? How do we do that? Well, Jesus says, you do it by trusting me. He said, you trust me. I've got this, okay? That's what Jesus is saying. Jesus is looking at him saying, I'm in control of the world. Look at the lilies. The lilies, they are, just absolutely, just when you look at them, they're clothed in splendor. They didn't do anything. They're going to be thrown in the oven. They're more beautiful than Solomon in how they dress. I did that. I took care of them, right? Look at the birds. The birds are insignificant. The birds are not created in God's image like you. They're not as important. They're not as valuable as you. They live and die and in between. They eat worms and fly into your windows, right? And so they're really insignificant, but I take care of them. How much more am I going to take care of you? See, that's what Jesus says. He says, you can worry all you want, but you have no control over what's going on in the world. You literally have no control over the cells in your body. You have no control. You can worry all you want, but it won't add a single moment to your life. It will add a lot of stress, but it will not add any time, okay? And so Jesus comes in, and Jesus says, man, do not worry, right? And so we're not canceling our in-person gathering because we're worried and fear-mongering and all this kind of stuff. That's not what we're doing. We're trying to slow it down to not overwhelm our hospitals. And when I say that, don't get me wrong. We're not talking about the plague here. We're not talking about, you know, Ebola. We're not talking about something that's a threat to what. We're talking about something that's not a huge threat, in the mortality rate at least, to the general public. It's a threat to certain segments, senior adults, people who have a suppressed immune system, who are on certain medications like chemotherapy or biologic drugs, people with diabetes. And you know what? We care about those people. We want to serve those people. And it's not just, tell our seniors to stay at home for a while because their grandkids come and their children are coming. They could take it home. So we want to do our part, not out of fear, but out of responsibility and out of love, okay? Because we love those segments. And we ask you, listen, do not worry. Do not fear. Let me tell you why else we don't need to worry. We don't need to worry because we don't know what God's up to in this moment. That's a general statement that you could apply when your marriage or when your job or when your kids, any issue you have, you could apply that because we don't know what God's up to. I'm reading the Bible through in a year, and so in my readings this week I read John 9, and I went, bam. That's great because in John 9, here's what happened. Jesus and his disciples are walking through town. His disciples say, Jesus, was this man born blind? They came upon a man who had been born blind since birth. He was born blind, so obviously he was blind since birth. And they ask a question. In their cultural worldview mindset, they were thinking, what happened to this man? And they said, Jesus, was it he who sinned, causing him to be born blind, or was it his parents? And Jesus said, neither. It wasn't he or his parents. It was so that the works of God might be displayed in him. And I thought, bam, that's exactly the way we need to look at the coronavirus, the COVID-19 or a war or whatever. This is not out of God's control, right? God is not sitting in heaven right now going, oh my goodness, this COVID-19, let's call the angels together. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are one God, but let's call that, what are we going to do about this? Let's call a heavenly emergency. It's not what they're doing. This is in God's plan. It's in his hands, and we don't know what he's doing, but wouldn't it be awesome? Right now, when we're looking back, oh man, I can't meet with my church family, and I hope it makes you sad. It makes me sad too, but rather than looking at it saying, that's a negative, What if we look back? Hindsight's always 20/20. Here's what I hope happens. I hope we look back on this, and I hope when we look back, we do this. We go, wow, man, we were so concerned about not meeting together, but here's what God was doing. God was scattering us. You know, we're to gather as a church, and we're to scatter, and sometimes we can gather and neglect to scatter, I think. What if we look back and said, you know what? God was scattering us so that we would gather scattered. I mean, what if we look back and said, man, listen, God was literally forcing us to live sent in our communities. God was causing us, all this stuff for the church, to be taken into our communities. And so what I want to challenge you to do is to not worry. Matter of fact, here's another verse. Proverbs 24:10 says this. Proverbs 24:10 says, if you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is small. You know what he's saying? Anybody can do well in good times. When times are good, it's anybody can do well. But, you know, I think this is our time to shine. It's our time to know, and I've heard it said, when the night is darkest, the light is brightest, and this is our time to let the light shine, the light of Christ shine through us. And so as believers, I think we need to understand worry is not our friend and panic is not our way. I read that somewhere in the last little bit. Worry is not our friend and panic is not our way. So let's make sure, folks, to show the world, let's make sure to show the world that we're governed by faith, not by fear. That we don't see this as a time to retreat, but as a time to advance. Not as a time to lay back, but as a time to lean in. And so we can present hope and light to our community in this time. And so don't worry, trust God. That's the first thing that I thought, man, we need to hear in this time. Here's another thing, a couple of more things. One is when it comes to the church, don't lay back, lean in. Here's why I say that, because you know, we have suspended our gatherings, and we didn't cancel church. We changed how we did it. But some people could use this as an opportunity to say, you know what, man, I'm gonna take a break. Folks, Christians, real believers do not take a break from the community. Real believers do not. There's no such thing as a break. There's no such thing as bench warmers, pew sitters, whatever you want to say. Real Christians don't lean back, lay back, they lean in, okay? And this is an opportunity for you to lean in more than ever, right? I don't know how long we're going to have to suspend our weekly in-person gatherings. It could be a handful of weeks. I don't know. We're going to inform you on a weekly basis, okay? We'll be videoing. We'll be shooting videos out. We'll be communicating. I don't know how long we're down. But however long we're down on an in-person basis, we're going to be up online rolling, all right? Not a time to take a break. It's a time to get busy. It's not a time to lay back. It's a time to lean in, all right? Now, let me tell you how you can do that. First, lean in by participating online. I mean, if you're watching this, you're already doing that, right? But lean in by participating online. And let me tell you what I would love for you to do, right? That, don't watch. This is not a television show, all right? This is a worship experience. This is a worship gathering. It's virtual, but it's a worship gathering. So we want you to get involved. I mean, we want you to literally, man, when Travis is leading and we say, man, stand with us, stand and sing, right? We want you to listen to God's word preached. We want you to take notes. We want you to do exactly what you do in person, right? This is not a spectator sport. And even in worship, this is a participation. And we want you to not lay back, but lean in. So actively engage in online worship. Actively engage, all right? And I would tell you to do this. I would ask you to do this. I would ask you to do that in a scheduled time, okay? Do that in a regularly scheduled time. Typically on Sunday mornings, we do 9 and 10:30. Then do 9 and 10:30 because if you say, man, I'll watch it at some point today, which sometimes you'll have to, and do it. If you have to watch it Sunday night or Monday, that's awesome. Please do it. We're not saying don't do it. But if your attitude is, I'll just watch it whenever, either you won't get around to it because I promise, man, my kids, there's always something urgent. And if I plan to do something at 3, there's always going to come in, Daddy, can we do this? Or I need this. Can you help me with it? Something's going to come up. And in a second, you might watch a little bit here and a little bit there, which would prohibit you from engaging. And so I would say schedule it. If you can do it at 9 or 10:30, do it when it's live. If not, then plan when you are going to do it. Maybe it's at 12, maybe it's at 2, maybe it's at 5 tonight. I'm getting the family together, but plan when you can do it and so that you can participate and do it. Now, let me give you a great reason that you might do it outside of 9 or 10:30, okay? This would be an awesome, awesome time for you to invite your neighbor to come to your house and worship with you. Wouldn't that be great? I mean, your neighbor's probably at home today. Maybe you've been talking to your neighbor. Maybe your neighbor's your one. I don't know. But wouldn't it be great to say, hey, neighbor, won't you come and worship with my family? I mean, here's some advantages. Number one, they can walk. Number two, the coffee's going to be a lot better, right? And so invite your neighbor or your one. How awesome would that be? I mean, you're one, the person that you're praying for, the person that you're absolutely asking God to save and do great things in life. You know what, man? They may be a little intimidated. They may be like, if I go to church, to your house? No, man, they've probably even been to your house. If not, they're not going to be intimidated. And so what an opportunity to invite your one to come to your house and watch with you. Or what about this, your small group? We've already, during our first gathering today, here's what we've seen. We've been seeing people post. Here's what I would love to see you do. Post that. Post your Some of them are small groups. Small groups are gathered together right now. And that's cool because this is not a quarantine, okay? We're not doing this quarantine. This is what's called social distancing, which basically deals with large groups, okay? And so small groups are cool. We want you to meet in small groups. Meet throughout the week. Worship in small groups. What a great time on Sunday to say, hey, let's join together Sunday morning at 9 or at 10:30 with your small group or at 5, maybe with your neighbor, your one, or your small group. You would do that and eat brunch or then eat lunch or maybe a meal in the evening. Whenever you can plan that as a group, but that would be awesome to do it together in small groups. Gather while we're scattered. That's an amazing thing, okay? And so lean in by engaging in worship. And so let's not, this coronavirus is quarantining some people, okay? As a matter of fact, I read this. I think there was a church in the New York area that met a week or two ago, and the person who was leading, one of their staff members who was leading, ended up testing positive for the coronavirus, and so they basically ask everybody in that church to self-quarantine, which is hundreds of people, and here it would be thousands. And so sometimes if you come in contact, you might need to self-quarantine, or if you got a cough, self-quarantine. You know the drill. Read the CDC. Let's not let this deal quarantine the gospel, okay? Let's let this deal absolutely cause us to propel the gospel and set it free unlike ever before, all right? And so, man, wouldn't it be awesome if we look back and we just saw how God was scattering the church and how God was forcing us to live sent. That would be awesome. So lean in by engaging in worship. Here's another thing, and I really don't want to understate this. It's very important that you lean in by continuing to give. It would be very easy right now. And to be quite honest with you, some people, man, if you're not at church, it's sort of out of sight, out of mind. You've heard that maybe. Or maybe people forget to give. 53% of our budget each week comes in online. People, I've set up, and mine just recurs. You can set up on through our website a recurring gift. You can set up an EFT with your bank that recurs. You can set it up to recur. If you've got a salary that's consistent, meaning your paycheck is pretty consistent, I would ask you to do that anyway. It helps you to be consistent. It helps us to be consistent. I hope that goes up. Some of you got inconsistent salaries, meaning you work, you get paid by the hour, your hours are different, or you have commissions, and so your check is different. Please go online and give. You can do it through the app, text to give. You can do it online, okay? And so through our website, our app, or guess what? The church is not closed. We're here. You need us, we're here through the week. We're praying for you. You can drop it off at church. Either way, do not let this cause you to take a, just like there's no opportunity or there's no biblical excuse, I will say, for a Christian to take a break from church and worship, there's no biblical excuse for us to take a break in our giving, all right? Now let me help you to understand that you're not having to give for the coronavirus relief, all right? When the tornadoes came through here in Tennessee, in Middle Tennessee, just a few weeks ago, devastating Nashville, Mount Juliet, Lebanon, Cookeville, we had a tornado relief, all in our area, and people are giving, and that's awesome. That's great. I'm glad you do and you did. That's awesome, okay? But in the coronavirus, there's no coronavirus relief. Matter of fact, you've already given to that. When you paid your taxes, a part of that goes to the branches of the government that help with this stuff, all right? Now, as you saw this week, the attack on it has gone into the private sector, which you got Walmart and Target and Walgreens and CVS and Roche and all those involved, and that's great, okay? Now, they're going to make money on it, so we don't have to give to coronavirus relief, but here's what we want you to do. We want you to obey God and His commands to giving to the church, giving the tithe through the storehouse, the church. Why? So that we can be prepared to literally meet the needs of people who are affected like never before in this community and around the world. Okay, we want to be prepared. Let me tell you what I've done. I've talked to Nathaniel Hale. Nathaniel is one of my executive pastors in charge of administration, and part of that is finance. And I've told Nathaniel to send out to our staff, and we're going to have a meeting here in a little after the service. We're going to have a meeting as a staff, and we're going to talk about this. We're going to freeze spending. I told Nathaniel I want to freeze spending within our church. Now, when you hear that, you're like, "Oh my goodness, is it that?" No, this is not reactive. It's not overreactive. That's not what we're trying to do. We're not freezing spending because we're afraid that people aren't going to give. No. We know you will. We're trying to be proactive, not reactive or overreactive, but proactive. And let me tell you what because I want to see us use this as an opportunity to advance and not retreat, as an opportunity to lean in, not lay back. And here's what I want to be ready to do. I want to be ready to freeze our spending so that we can have money, and then we'll rework our spending plan so that we can have funds available to help people in need. All right? We can have funds available to help people in our, if we got members in our church who their small business has to cut back, and we want to be able to help people in our own family, okay? And so we want to be able to help people with that. Now, here's another thing. I want to be able to help churches. Let me tell you that 26 years ago, I came to LifePoint. And when I came here, before I came here, I served a church, and I was in seminary, young seminarian. Me and Amy and I, and we had, two young sons, and we had absolutely nothing. We had no money, man. I mean, we lived on love. You've heard that. We had a lot of love, but we had a little money. All right. I mean, we were paycheck to paycheck. You've been there, probably. We were paycheck to paycheck, and I served a church when I was in seminary, and every Monday, here's what happened. We did not know if we were going to get paid until we counted the money on Monday. Man, we'd come in on Monday, and all the staff was like, "Man, we're praying that we got enough to pay the salaries, right?" Because, I mean, I'm a young seminarian. I've got a young family. I need it to survive. Well, thank the Lord. When I came to LifePoint, man, you guys are absolutely generous. You're faithful. Man, we've got reserves because of that, and so we're not freezing because we don't have reserves and that stuff. We're freezing because here's what we want to do. There are churches all over the country that are not meeting today. I don't know how long they'll have to be out. We're blessed. We have the opportunity to be able to worship online. We have the opportunity to be able to give online. We're blessed. God has blessed us with that. And I'm so thankful. Thank you, Jesus, that we're able to do that. But let me tell you, there's churches all over the country that it will be devastated by not meeting. They really will. There will be churches who will be devastated. And here's what I don't want to happen. I don't want a church to be responsible and to say, "Man, I want to serve our community and we can't meet. But if I do, then I don't know if we can pay our pastor," right? And so when this is all said and done, I want you to know if there are churches and their pastor and they can't pay their pastor, I don't want his family to suffer. And if we can at all help pay their salary for a week or pay their salary, we want to be able to do that, okay? We want to be able to help churches because we believe in the local church, and man, we want to be able to help churches. And so, man, we're preparing to advance. We're not preparing to retreat. Okay, we want to lean in. We don't want to lay back. Matter of fact, we have churches in our community here. Kyle, our Riverdale campus pastor, spoke to a pastor last night that says, "Man, I got to meet tomorrow." And they probably don't know how many's going to be there, but he doesn't have the ability to go online. And I want to tell you, we got a lot of pastors that watch right now. We got a lot of pastors each week that watch. And I saw some pastors commenting at the first gathering. And so here's what I want to tell you. If you're a pastor and you're watching and you do not have the capability or the resources to do an online deal, here's what we'll do. We'll make available all of our resources and our people to record your sermons. Have you come down, we'll record your sermon. We'll give you the digital file. You can send it out on your website to your people, okay? All you got to do is call us and let us know. We'll schedule that, and we'll help you. We believe in churches, and we want to help churches, okay? We really do. We want to help our people, and so that's why we're going to do our part, and we're going to free spending, not overreactive out of fear, but proactive out of a plan, okay, out of a vision of helping churches, okay? And so man, we want to do that, and so we ask you, give online, give on the app, Bring it in if you have to, but if you can set it up to recur, do that. I would love to see our giving go, our weekly budget go from 50 to 70%, man. I mean, just give. That's what we're saying, all right? And so you can do that online, and please do so. And so the third thing I want to as we close here, the third thing I want to ask you to do is, number one, don't worry, trust God. Number two, when it comes to church, don't lay back, lean in. And number three, here's what I would ask you. Don't be selfish, be sacrificial. Don't seek your own welfare. Seek the welfare of the city. You know, here's what Jeremiah 29:7 says, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. Did you get that? Seek the welfare of the city. Amy and I were setting last night, and I was working on my sermon we were setting, and then I just, you know, had to take a mind break a little bit, and so we were watching Survivor or something, I don't know, and I was watching, we were watching a TV show, and Amy stopped, and she read a excerpt to me, and I don't know where she got it, but there was a man in Tennessee, I'm ashamed to say he's from Tennessee, there was a man in Tennessee who had 17,000 bottles of hand sanitizer. Now, why am I ashamed? If he had 17,000 bottles of hand sanitizer because, man, he was going to sacrificially say, I've got these and I want to help meet needs, I would be pumped and proud of that man in Tennessee. But I was ashamed. Why? Because he knew there was an opportunity coming, and he bought 17,000 or I don't know how many thousand, but he still has 17. He bought, and he's got 17,000 bottles of hand sanitizer that he was selling on Amazon for as much as $70 a bottle. Can you believe that? I mean, man, that some people would call that capitalism. I would call that selfish in a time like this, right? Don't be selfish. Be sacrificial, okay? Don't seek your welfare. Seek the welfare of this. Don't just seek your welfare, I mean, okay? Obviously, you know, we're interested in your welfare, but don't just seek your welfare. Seek the welfare of the city. How can we do that? How can we do that in this time? Listen, man, we've got healthcare professionals that are working around the clock. We've got doctors, we've got nurses. They've instituted their emergency protocols. Our local hospital, Stonecrest, was in contact with us this week, with Nathaniel Hale, our executive pastor of administration, about their emergency protocols, which include our building. And if we need to, they can use our building, right, for different and various things. And we obviously willingly serve our community that way. And so you need to be thinking, what can we do, man? They're working around the clock. Can we pray for them? First off, you pray that God gives them wisdom, that God gives them stamina and strength, that God gives them protection. Pray for them, right? When you see them, thank them for what they do. Man, can we take them baskets to their so that they can be in their staff rooms and stuff like that, of snacks and all those kind of things? And so think of our healthcare professionals, okay? Pray for them. If there's somebody in your circle that actually has to self-quarantine, if we know of anybody that has self-quarantine, can we go get groceries and put them on their porch? How can we serve them, right? I mean, can we send them notes of encouragement? Can we FaceTime with those people so that they're not lonely? What can we do to serve, seek the welfare of our city? Here's one that I'm really, 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 that's on my heart. Our schools, as you know, out of responsibility, have closed. And all of our school administrators and all of our teachers, and man, thank you for what you do, and thank you for the hard decisions, the agonizing decisions you have to make in test time. So thank you for taking your responsibility serious, and we know you were agonizing like we were. Here's the issue with that I want us to get involved in. In that situation, all these kids that are home, and many of them, we have a lot of schools here in our area that 70% of the students are on either free lunch or greatly reduced lunch. We do backpacks full of food. We have a backpack program that we do that takes and gives kids at the schools backpacks of food to take home for the weekend so they have food, okay? Now, many of these kids, the only meal they have, Bobby Bones, I heard this week, was saying, don't forget those kids, those free lunch kids. He's worried about them because he says, he was one of those kids, and he said sometimes that was the only meal that he got throughout the day. Man, I don't want that to be the case. And so here I've instructed Peyton Bullen, our missions pastor, and Ken Hampton's going to be working with him, and Erica and those, they're going to be trying to figure out how can we help with kids who need food through the week, okay? We might be asking you and calling you and saying, hey, bring some food by the church, some non-perishables, what, I don't know yet, but we're looking, what can you do? We're going to seek the welfare of our city, okay? We're not going to be selfish. We're going to be sacrificial. We're not going to just seek our own welfare and buy up 17,000 bottles of hand sanitizer and, you know, and all the toilet paper in Rutherford County and all around the world and all the beans and rice. We're not going to do that, all right? We're going to seek the welfare of our city and be sacrificial. We challenge you to do that. So I hope today that you have seen an incredible opportunity, and that you don't lean in. This virus, you know, it's very contagious. But man, I want you to be more contagious with your faith. It can bring fear. Let's bring hope, okay? Let's bring hope. We can't do anything about the virus, folks. I mean, there are some great healthcare professionals that are working on vaccines. We can't, but here's what we know. We worship the one who holds it all, okay? We worship the one who holds it all. I hope you see our plan, our vision. I hope you feel reassured from God's word today. And right now, here's what I want to do. I want Travis and our band to come back up. And where you are in your living room, in your, you know, car, hopefully you're not driving, but in your car, wherever you are right now, I want us to end this thing by singing one of my most favorite songs, You Hold It All, because it talks about who holds it all. That's Jesus. That's what he's talking about in Matthew chapter 6. I got you. I got it all. Don't worry. You don't have to worry about all these things. I got it. We don't know what God's up to, but I can't wait to look back and see what he does, knowing that he holds it all. Makes all the difference in the world in your perspective. So he holds it all. I want to pray and I want to thank God. I want us to pray together. So wherever you are, let's all stand and let's pray together. And let's thank God that he is working. We don't know his plan, but we trust him and we know he's got it. And let's sing together at this, as we begin to close out our gathering together. Father, we love you. God, we are in a crazy time in our world, and Father, we look back. We'll look back on this time, because this too shall pass. We know that. We'll look back on this time, and Lord, I pray that when we look back, we'll see that all the fear and all the concern and all of the, God, all of the frustration that we felt will be overshadowed by looking and seeing all that you've done. I pray that we would see how you reset our lives as believers. God, how we once again are very thankful for a community of where we can gather together. We have the freedom to do it and the ability to do it, and we wouldn't take it for granted, but we would begin to commit. I'm going to take advantage of being with my family. Lord, help us to realize that in this time. God, I pray that's one great positive thing. I pray that we would identify with our brothers and our sisters all over the world who literally cannot meet consistently because of persecution. Maybe they're underground. I pray that we would identify with them and we would say, Lord, we want to ask that you bless them. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship together online. God, I pray, Lord, for all the frustration. I pray for any fear to be dispelled, because we know that you hold it all. We ask that you would give mercy to our country and to the world by helping medical professionals. And God, we pray that you would stop the spread, whether it's warm weather, God, whether it's medical, whatever. God, we know no matter where it comes from, it's in your hand. And it will come from you ultimately. And God, we just pray that you would have mercy upon our world at this time. We declare, we know, we trust that you hold it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's sing this together, knowing that he is our hope, he's our confidence, he's in control. We surrender our fear, our worry to him. He holds it all. Come on. From the highest of mountains, lift your voice. From the highest of mountains to the depths of the sea. Planets in motion to the breath that we breathe, from the womb of the barren to the rich and the poor, and to the dreams of the orphan. Every heartbeat is yours.
Come on, declare it, sing, you hold it all.
You hold it all. Tribe, every nation, every country and king, every tongue, every language, and every song that we sing.
All of the universe, all of us, you hold it all. Thank you that you are before all things, that in you all things hold together. God, we're thankful to serve you, a God who literally spoke all of creation into existence, who knits together every person ever conceived in their mother's womb, and who in the midst of this moment continues to rule and reign in the midst of our chaos. God, thank you that you have put us sovereignly in a moment that allows us to be able to gather together, even like this, to gather in unique and creative ways. God, thank you for the gift that is to us in these moments. Thank you for the opportunity you've given us to not lay back, but to lean in, that we might help people find life and live sent no matter where we find ourselves, no matter how distanced we are, that would be our aim, God. Thank you for this time together. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Before we sign off for this gathering, we just want to remind you of a couple things. First, this service is almost immediately on demand and available, and we want to encourage you to share it. We want to encourage you to post online, share stories of how and where and with whom you have gathered to watch this and be a part of this gathering today. And last, we just want to remind you, if you go to lifept.org/give, there's all kinds of creative ways for you to not miss this moment, to not lay back when it comes to your stewardship during this time, but to lean in with us as we look faithfully to the Lord who's in charge of all of this and holding all of this together. So give. You can mail in checks. You can give online. You can swing by the office and drop things off. We want to encourage you to do that during this season. Thanks so much for being a part of this gathering. Whether you're a Smyrna campus, a family or individual, or you go to the Stewart's Creek or Riverdale campus, or you are just checking things out for the first time and haven't yet been to one of our campuses, thank you for being a part of this gathering today. We can't wait to worship again next week. God bless you, LifePoint.